working in northern Italy, in Lombardy, and at the Posillipo Parini, a very beautiful location, and the Scientific Institute for Research, Hospitalization and Healthcare at the Eugenio Medea Foundation. And then Manuela works actually trying to convince clinicians on the clinical importance of understanding evolution. And I think this is actually what Manuela will be showing today, on a focus on herpes viruses. So Manuela, all yours.
Thank you, Nacho. Thank you so much. So thank you so much, really, for this invitation. So yes, we basically work on virus evolution. We also work on coronaviruses, but I think we had enough. So today I decided to talk about herpes viruses. So as you probably all know, herpes viruses are a large family of viruses. They infect many mammals, and they have large and complex double-stranded DNA genome. So for instance, this one is the genome of human cytomegalovirus, and it's about 250 kb long. And typically, herpes virus genomes have a certain number of core genes, meaning genes that are shared among different herpes viruses, and a certain number of non-core genes that are specific to viral species or genome. Human herpes viruses in general have a high prevalence in human populations. For sure, you're familiar with labial herpes, which is the herpes virus 1. That can also cause, unfortunately, neonatal herpes when it's conducted during birth. You are familiar, of course, with chickenpox and with the possibly devastating effects of human cytomegalovirus infection when contracted in the other. So the genetic diversity of human infected herpes viruses is very different. So for instance, here we have human cytomegalovirus, herpes simplex virus 1, and varicella zoster virus. So if you look at the scale, you realize, for instance, that the diversity of cytomegalovirus is much higher than for varicella zoster and herpes simplex virus 1. And also these viruses have different geographic structure. So for instance, in the case of varicella zoster virus, we have specific clades that tend to be mainly transmitted in specific geographic areas. The same or less holds true for the same virus, but not, it's not the case for herpes simplex 1 virus, which shows no geographic structure. So coming to their phylogenetic relationships, the human infecting herpes viruses are closely related to viruses that infect great apes and monkeys. In general, there is a good correspondence between the phylogeny of the viruses and the phylogeny of their host, which suggests that co-speciation was a common process during the evolution of the viral family. However, because an increasing number of viral genomes is being sequenced, we are starting to realize that host-shift events have also been common during the evolution of this viral family. Coming to a host range, in general, herpes viruses have a very restricted host range, and there are species-specific. So in the case of human viruses, for instance, we have a varicella zoster, human cytomegalovirus, and EBV that are fully human specific, highly specificity. Different is the situation for herpes simplex virus 1 and 2 because these viruses have a single natural host, meaning humans, and so they are species specific, but they can cross the species barrier, as we will see in a while. Okay, so the idea that co-speciation and co-divergence were major evolutionary processes during the evolution of this viral family and their species specificity led to the widespread idea that human herpes viruses originated in Africa with early humans, and out of Africa they migrated during the major out of Africa migration of anatomically modern humans. So for those of you who are not familiar with this, we know that anatomically modern humans left Africa about 60,000 years ago in a single major migration event and then populated the world. And indeed, we know that some viruses did migrate with humans. So this is the case of human papillomavirus 16, for instance, as Nacho very clearly demonstrated, but also of JC polyomavirus. So this virus is most likely left Africa with early humans and they populated the world. However, what is becoming also clear recently is that viral lineage extinction is a very common phenomenon. This became particularly clear when ancient viral genomes were sequenced, and therefore, for instance, some hepatitis B viruses that were transmitted long ago are no longer transmitted in human population, implying viral lineage extinction. So the first herpes virus we analyzed was varicella zoster virus. As I said, it has a very clear geographic structuring, but the group of Balu, and so, and it's highly human specific, so it was thought to have an African origin and thus migrated out of Africa with early humans. However, it came from the group of François Balu. The dating of the plate of the varicella zoster plates showing that it diverged about 5,000 years ago, which is much not consistent clearly with 60,000 years ago of the out of Africa exit. And we performed phylogeography and population structure analysis for varicella zoster virus, and to make it short, what we found is that circulating strains have a most likely European and not African ancestry. So clearly these two factors, time frame and the origin, are not consistent with early out of Africa migration. And of course, this does not imply that varicella zoster virus is not infected early humans, but maybe that those early lineages are vaccine. So we now move to herpes simplex virus 1 and 2, that are the major topic of this talk. So as I said, herpes simplex virus 1 is primarily responsible for a larval herpes, whereas herpes simplex virus 2 is mainly sexually transmitted. The prevalence of both viruses is high. It's much higher for herpes simplex virus 1. And the highest prevalence for herpes simplex virus 1 is in Africa, but also in some regions, the Mediterranean region, and also in the Western Pacific. In the case of herpes simplex virus 2, its highest prevalence is again is in Africa, and the second highest prevalence is in the Americas. So this is a phylogeny of simplex viruses that infect primates and their hosts. As you can see, there is a very good correspondence with clearly two most likely host shifts events. And the one that is most relevant to the content of this topic is this event here. So we basically think that the herpes simplex virus 2 entered an ancestor of early of modern humans through the cross-species transmission event from the chimpanzee virus. And this happened some million years ago. So we start with the herpes simplex virus 2, and if we have a look at its genetic diversity, it's basically recapitulated by two major clades, a worldwide clade with viruses sampled all over the world, and an African clade with mainly African viruses. So it was generally thought that the worldwide clade was the one that left Africa with early humans and populated the world. However, if we have a look at nucleotide diversity, for instance, of the clades, we see that it's very similar, which is not much consistent with early out of Africa migration and the bottlenecks and migration bottlenecks that result. So we use population structure to analyze the population structure of the simplex virus 2. So structure analysis is basically a Bayesian method that clusters genotypes into populations without prior information about geographic location or relatedness. So basically, structuring the linkage model that we use assumes that each viral genome is constituted by chunks of genomes deriving from a certain number of ancestral populations. So what you see in this graph here is that each line is a genome, and the colors depict the proportion of ancestry deriving from the different ancestral components or populations. And the program also estimates the best number of populations, but in this case was estimated to be 2. So as you can clearly see, there is a very good structure is very good at distinguishing the African clade and the worldwide clade and the worldwide component, although there is some level of mixture. And what structure also does, it computes a drift parameter for the ancestral populations. So basically, this is it estimates based on allele frequency, kind of FST, the drift away of the ancestral population from a hypothetical ancestral population. And as you can see here, the worldwide component has lower drift than the African component, which is clearly not consistent with an early out of Africa migration, because in that case, you would expect much higher drift for this component. So we use phylogeography to establish distinguish which is the most likely origin of the triplet. And for both of them, we found that it was performed in this. I'm just cutting a little bit on the details, otherwise we just wasted a lot of time. What we got is that from both the worldwide chain and for the African trait, the best support is for an African origin. So we have contrasting findings. We have here finding that the viruses of which is Africa, but our data on structure and genetic diversity are not consistent with an early out of Africa exit. So what we wanted to do was to date the time when the worldwide plague left Africa. So as you probably all know, tip dating is a very good method to for molecular dating. However, tip dating is very good for events that are recent in the past, but not for events that are that occurred in a more distant past. This is because of the time dependency rate phenomenon of substitution rate, which basically tells us that if we measure substitution rates over short time frames, they appear to be much higher than if we measure them over longer time frames. And this most likely due to the fact that there are substitution saturation and purifying selection and probably other effects. So the good thing with the TBRP effect, however, as the group in Oxford showed, is that it can be very well modeled by a power loaded tree, which means that if we log transform rates and time frames, we get regression lines that very well fit measured substitution rate. And they also very well measure fit substitution rates that were obtained from ancient viral genes. The other good thing is that we can use this regression line and its parameters to correct our time estimate for the TBRP effect. So basically we get the regression line of double-stranded DNA viruses, we get its slope and intercept, and we use these parameters to correct our branch length estimates and transform them into time estimates. So that's what we did with the herpes-simplex virus to phylogeny. And what we got is that the out of Africa exit of the worldwide plate occurred about 260 years ago. And the two plates separated about 1,000 years ago, which is clearly not consistent with an out of Africa exit with early humans, but it's consistent with the worldwide plate exiting Africa during the slave trade, because this is the time when the slave trade, the transatlantic slave trade, was at its peak. So this basically reconciles the idea that the virus originated, the worldwide plague originated in Africa, but its migration occurred very recently. And it also reconciles with the idea that the second highest prevalence of the virus is in America. So this is the population structure of herpes simplex virus 1. I will go very fast. There's basically no population structure, as we have seen also here. We also inferred an African origin for the virus. And if you use the same method to date its out of Africa exit, we obtain a time of about 5,000 years. Okay, the interesting thing here is that if we use tip dating on the phylogeny and we get the substitution rate, the substitution rate very well fits the regression line we use for correction. And if we use tip dating, we have a time of 150 years ago, which is one order of magnitude more recent than if we consider time dependence rate phenomenon. So basically, we have seen that the two viruses have migrated from Africa with relatively recent times. And of course, again, these data do not imply that viruses did not infect the humans, but maybe that the early lineages went extinct. So next, what we wanted to do was to study the adaptation of simplex viruses to their host. So as I said, the cross-species transmission of a simplex virus has been documented several times, indicating there are few barriers in terms of infection potential. However, most spillovers are a result in a very, very severe disease in the new host. So the best example of this is the virus. The virus is a virus that infects macaques, and when it's transmitted to humans, it has a fatality rate of about 70% with encephalitis. So it's a very important concern for people working in primate facilities. Another example is herpes simplex virus 1, the human virus, that when it's transmitted to newborn monkeys, it's almost invariably fatal. So this basically implies that these viruses must have adapted to coexist with their hosts with little harm. So we started by trying to find the events that accounted for adaptation of simplex viruses, simplex virus 2 and 1, and the chimpanzee virus to the hominin hosts. Basically, what we did was to apply branch sites tested to search for evidence of positive selection on this branch here of ethology. So we get 11 positive selection in 11 genes. Some of these were core, some of these were non-core. For the non-core genes, we found that more selected sites are located in dominant epitopes. And for the non-core genes, we found that most of them are in immunomodulatory causes. Basically suggesting that the major selective ratio was exerted by the host immune system. So we wanted to, of course, we expected positive selective site as a phenotype effect, and we wanted to test the phenotype, the effect or characterize the positive selective site in one of these genes, and we selected the gene encoding for ICP47. So ICP47 is a short molecule, a short protein, and the proteins expressed by herpes simplex virus 1 and 2 basically are the TAP inhibitors. So TAP is the transporter of peptides across the endoplasmic reticulum, and these peptides are then loaded onto HLA class 1 molecules for antigen presentation. So if you block TAP activity, you basically have down modulation of HLA class 1 expression as a cell surface. So what we know is that B virus is unable to block TAP and non-modulate the HLA class 1 expression in the plasma membrane. But infection of human cells with B virus results in upregulation of HLA-G and HLA-A, which are two immunomodulatory molecules. So we found that the positive selective sites in ICP47 were all located in the N-terminus, and this short region of the N-terminus is necessary and sufficient to block TAP. So we generated plasmids and constructs with mutants for ICP47, and basically we use the human virus sequence to recapitulate the state, the amino acid state observed in the virus, and we mutagenize the virus too. Recapitulate the state of the human virus. So if we analyze the plasma membrane expression of HLA class 1 molecules, we see that HSV1 and HSV2 down-modulate HLA class 1, but if we mutagenize the site, they no longer down-modulate. And the effect is not evident for B virus. So B virus, even if we recapitulate the state in the human viruses, we do not have inhibition of HLA class 1 expression. So this tells us that the positive selective sites are involved in TAP binding and inhibition, but they are not the only determinants. And I just want to recall you that, of course, down-modulation of HLA class 1 molecules is good for the virus in a sense, because it prevents presentation of viral antigens, but also makes cells susceptible to missing self activation by NK cells. So if there is no HLA class 1 molecule at the cell surface, NK cell lies the cells. Okay, so next what we did was to study the effect of the mutants on HLA-G expression. And what we found is that herpes simplex virus 1 and 2 do not upregulate HLA-G, but if we mutagenize the positive selective site, we have a strong overexpression, which is observed in B virus, but it's lost in B virus when we mutagenize it to recapitulate the state of the human viruses. So basically, this tells us that the modulatory effect of B virus on HLA-G is mediated by ICP47 and terminal domain, and that positive selective sites are important determinants of HLA-G regulation. So HLA-G, as I said, it's an immunomodulatory molecule. Therefore, even if the cell, the infected cell, spread presents viral epitopes, antigens, the presence, the expression of HLA-G blocks NK cell activation. So basically, this is the situation where herpesvirus inhibition of NK cell activation, whereas we know that herpes simplex 1 and 2 are highly sensitive to NK cell mediated killing. And we think that this observation might contribute to explain the extreme virulence of the virus in humans. Of course, the question is why the virus is not virulent in macaques. The interesting thing is that in macaques, HLA-G is the gene. So these animals have a mammal AG gene, which is functionally similar to HLA-G, but it's phylogenetically related to HLA-G. And therefore, it's possible that the mammal AG, the macaque HLA-G-like molecule, is not upregulated by ACP40. We don't know because there are no available antibodies for it. In any case, it's clear that the evolution of ICP47 determined the loss of immunosuppressive effect, and which suggests that indeed these viruses are trying to modulate suppressive and stimulatory pathways to promote coexistence with their host. We next wanted to study also the adaptation specifically of these viruses to the human host. And we did this, we took advantage of the peculiar history of herpes simplex virus 2. As I said, it was transmitted by a chimpanzee virus some years ago. And therefore, we have a very good outgroup, which is the chimpanzee virus. So we basically use a method that uses interspecies diversity and divergence data to estimate selection coefficients and positive safety sets. So we found 20 positive safety genes. Some of them were core and some were non-core, but what we immediately realized is that the majority of positive safety sites were located in these red regions here, which are in principle disorder regions. Regions, I guess you all know, are regions that do not adopt the contact structure in the structure of the protein. And we know that in general, disorder regions are evolved faster and are very commonly involved in protein-protein interaction. So we wonder whether herpes simplex virus 1 and 2 have higher fraction of disorder compared to other human infecting herpes viruses, and we found this to be the case. They clearly have a higher fraction of disorder, and this effect is not due to some outlier genes, because if we compare artelopes in varicella zoster and HSV2, for instance, we see that all the there is a strong overrepresentation in all genes, most genes, of the disorder region in HSV2. Also, we wonder whether this effect might be due to the fact that HSV1 and 2 have GC-rich template GC-rich genomes, but we did not find any correlation between disorder at the gene level, disorder and GC content. So we instead found that the simplex virus proteins that interact with human proteins have higher disorder compared to viral proteins that do not interact with human proteins, which suggests that these proteins are evolving to optimize interaction. So we wonder whether the opposite was also true for the human proteins. So we analyzed the human proteins that interact with simplex viruses, human cytomegalovirus, ABD or Kaposi's sarcomavirus, and you see that proteins, human proteins that interact with herpes simplex viruses tend to have higher level of disorder compared to those that interact with other viruses, which basically suggests that viruses that interact with fast evolving and disordered human proteins interact evolve disorder viral interactors. And we also think that maybe the higher fraction of disorder in these viruses may account for the wider host range compared to other herpes viruses. Okay, now I'm moving to the last part of the presentation, which is about human cytomegalo, which is, as I said, very different from herpes simplex virus 1 and 2, because human cytomegalovirus is highly specific, and it's highly specific which means in the absence of the host adaptive in the organism. Therefore, human cytomegalo can replicate at very low levels in chimpanzee cells, but cannot replicate at all in cells from other non-human primates. And the specificity is driven by host entry, which suggests that human cytomegalo must have adapted to complete successfully its replication, cycle in human cells. So this is a phylogeny of primate infected cytomegalos. Here we have the three strains of the human cytomegalo virus and the closest phylogeny, which is again a chimpanzee virus. So just very briefly, for those of you who are not familiar with human cytomegalo, so it has the largest genome among viruses that infect humans, about 250 kb, high worldwide seroprevalence, and it's a very important opportunistic pathogen for immunocompromised people, and it's also the most common cause, infectious cause of birth defects. So I skip this one. So again, we wanted to study adaptation of human cytomegalo to the human host, again using a branch cycles on this branch here of the phylogeny. And so we identified a large number of positive selected genes, more than 100. And what we found is that core genes are more frequently targeted at positive selection compared to non-core genes. Well, even though core genes tend to be more evolutionary constraints, they still have a higher frequency of positive selection. And many positive selected genes that are also core genes contribute to this interaction networks, which is involved in viral maturation and the rest. We also found that one key and core viral enzyme, UL70, was a target of positive selection. UL70 encodes for the viral priming. So, of course, again, we expect the positive selected sites to have a functional effect, and we wanted to test the site in UL70. So this was done by generating infectious recombinant viruses using the BAC technology. And basically, we multigenized the two positive selected sites in the primase with, so as to recapitulate the amino acid state we observed in primate infecting viruses. And of course, we generated guanine and neurons as controls. As you can see from here, the three neurons generate larger plaques compared to the wild type and compared to the alanine neurons. And you can see it here, the average plaque area is higher. And importantly, these plaques have a higher number of positive cells, suggesting that the virus, the mutant viruses are replicating at higher efficiency. We tested this directly by performing head-to-head competition assays. So basically, you infect these cells with a one-to-one ratio of the mutant and the wild type, and then you see which, if one species and where the species is competing the other. And what we had is that the three mutants outcompeted the wild type. So basically, it tells us that the effect of the positive selected site is to increase rather than decrease viral replication in mice cells, which was against what we expected. Honestly, we expected the mutants would have lower efficiency for replication in mice cells. However, we interpreted this together with many other data from human cytomegalo again to as a temporary phenomenon, meaning that the virus is replicating in human cells, trying to replicate at a level that allows coexistence with the host. Clearly, this is just an interpretation of the data. Okay, we also analyzed the more recent cycling events in human cytomegalo. And specifically, basically sites that are polymorphic and with the segregating diversity in circulating strains, which derive from many different compartments. And so I will make this very short. We found that most positive selected sites are located in genes involved in immune response or in immunodominant epitopes of these genes. And but an unexpected finding was that a higher than expected fraction of positive selected sites was located in the signal peptides of the viral protein. So you probably all know signal peptides are small, sharp protein regions, usually in the N-terminus, that are necessary for protein trafficking. So we know that as soon as the signal to protein is translated, it's bound by signal recognition particle, which binds, which settles it to a pore channel, which is known as translocon in the endoplasmic reticulum, and then the protein is co-translationally inserted in the, into the endoplasmic reticulum, and then the signal to protein is cleared. So we studied the signal peptide and the phagocytic site in one viral protein, which is UL144, a protein with immunomodulatory functions. So we generated two constructs that only differ for the phagocytic site at the signal peptide. So we refer to these constructs as genotype A and genotype B because they recapitulate known genotypes of UL144 in human cytometry. So to make it short, what we found is that the trafficking of genotype B is delayed compared to trafficking of genotype A. So this was done by performing a time course confocal microscopy. So what we have is that at 3 hours post-transfection, GTA is associated with the translocon and GTB is also associated with the translocon, but at 4 hours post-transfection, GTA is no longer with the translocon, it's trafficking to the cell compartment, while GTB, genotype B, is still there. And even a little bit at 5 hours. So one reason that this late trafficking may be due to late removal of the signal peptide. So we use a system depicted here where we have a flag, a dedicated flag, which can be recognized when it has a free N-terminus, meaning when the signal peptide is cleared. So at 3 hours post-transfection, you see that GTA is all green, meaning it's all cleared, but GTB is not cleared. It's still all uncleared, which is recapitulated here. So the fraction of uncleared signal peptide at 3 hours is much, much higher for the GTB than for GTA, and still there at 4 hours post-transfection. So the signal peptide of genotype B is removed late. And you might wonder who cares about this, but for instance, HIV one cares about the timing of the removal of the single peptide of its envelope protein. So the single peptide of the envelope protein is also a target of positive selection. And this other field shows that differences in the single peptide modulate the antigenic properties of the envelope protein, viral infectivity, and the glycosylation of the protein. So the reason for this is most likely that a longer stay in the endoplasmic reticulum allows for a slightly different folding and slightly different glycosylation that in turn affect antigenic properties and other properties. Of course, we are now trying to assess whether the two isoforms of UL144 are differentially glycosylated. So I think we have very little time. I just wanted to remark that the safety events that occur during the human cytomegalovirus speciation are very different from those that occur in interspecies variation nowadays. Those were more closely related to core genes and core viral processes, and whereas circulating viruses are mainly working to avoid the host immune response. And please don't remember that although they are removed from the major proteins, signal peptides can contribute to virus adaptation. So I just stop here because we are late, and I want to thank people in my lab for doing most of the work, and also people in the University of Milano, and people from the University of Torino for doing the back experiments with human cytomegalovirus. And thank you so much for your attention.
Thanks a lot, Manu. The sound was, let's say, of average quality. I hope that some of the slides may have been difficult to follow. I hope that it was clear. I mean, even if the figures on the slides were very clear. So please, if you want to, so I don't know whether you may have any question. If you may have any question in the Q&A or in the chat, then I will.
Oh, okay. Wait a sec.